Becoming Thelma Lou, My Journey to Hollywood, Mayberry, and Beyond, by Betty Lynn, with Jim Clark and Tim McAbee, narrated by Kathy Garver. Foreword. My friend, my Mayberry mentor, my adopted family, my counselor, Betty Lynn was all of these things, and much more to me. My first encounters with Betty included working out the logistics of getting her from Los Angeles to Mount Airy. For her first trip to Mayberry Days in 2001, Betty was on the same flight from Los Angeles to Charlotte as Howard Morris. She was seated in coach, while Howard had booked himself for a seat in first class. Howard purposefully misbehaved so much that the flight attendants moved Betty to first class to help with him. Howard's intent all along. Another year, Betty called me from an LAX ticket counter to let me know that she had missed her flight. She immediately handed the phone to the ticket agent who worked with me to find a way to get Thelma Lou to Mayberry Days. After her appearances each year at Colonel Tim's Talent Time, the big closing show at Mayberry Days, I would take Betty back to her hotel or to her apartment after she moved to Mount Airy. She and I would sit in my car and talk for hours. Betty would describe all the things she loved about Mayberry Days, as well as Mayberry in general, and confide about all the things that she didn't particularly like and thought should be changed. I would express my views and confess to her in return. Each of us knew that we could confide with confidence. Betty loved being in Mount Airy and spending time with her fans. She remembered their names, and she remembered their joys and their sorrows. Betty had a sincere empathy for others. A few years after she began coming to Mayberry Days, Betty started talking about making Mount Airy her home. Talk became reality when she moved to Mount Airy on January 17, 2007. Hobart and I picked Betty up at the Charlotte Airport. Prior to her arrival, I had directed the placement of the many, many boxes that were packed by movers in Los Angeles and sent to Mount Airy. Betty moved into her new nest with a gorgeous view of the Blue Ridge Mountains. She loved watching the changes of the seasons. Her new hometown welcomed her with lots of burgers, fans, and most of all, love. Taxi drivers, in awe that they were helping Thelma Lou, carried her groceries to her apartment. She got special treatment in all aspects of her life. I would hear about Betty's activities from others in town before Betty herself had a chance to tell me. Mount Airy is definitely a small town. People keep an eye on each other. They observe Betty's every move with both goodwill and curiosity. Betty adjusted quickly to Mount Airy. She was every bit as attuned an observer as those who were observing her. Her visits to the Andy Griffith Museum remain memorable for thousands upon thousands of fans. She loved telling fans that I was her agent and arranged her schedule. The reality was that I simply did whatever she instructed me to do. Betty was a part of my family and my daily life. She called Hobart our husband. She attended my children's out-of-town weddings, and she was at all of our family holiday and other gatherings. My grandchildren thought she was magical. She told Ryan and Skylar that fairies were real, and that became a matter of fact in their lives. Parker loved taking flowers to her and getting her wonderful hugs. They all just simply couldn't believe that they knew Thelma Lou. Betty always knew that I was there for her when she needed me. From time to time, she had challenges. Betty had a major surgical procedure shortly after she moved to Mount Airy. Hobart and I sat in the waiting room at a Winston-Salem hospital for hours as the surgeon worked miracles. Betty became so close to the surgeon that when, after a few years of follow-up, he told her that he was considering releasing her from his care, Betty asked him...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.